Well, it's great to see everybody here. It looks like a good-sized group. Now, I was really glad when the admissions office asked me to do this presentation, because I think a lot of times the nature of Christendom's academic program, although it's one of the strongest aspects of Christendom College, I would argue the strongest aspect of Christendom College is its academic program. It actually is something that sometimes gets lost in the shuffle. Sometimes it gets a little bit overlooked, particularly for parents, when you're looking at sending your kids to college, there's a lot that you're concerned about. You have a lot of worries about your kids going off on their own, losing their faith. What's the moral environment going to be like? Are they going to have the sacraments? You know, and Christendom is as solid as it comes on all of those fronts. But we're also proud to say, and that I think this is really, I think, the clincher for choosing a college. We're proud to say here that we have what many of us would argue is the finest program in integrated liberal studies available anymore in the United States of America, right? Integrated study of the liberal arts is something that was a really strong tradition in American education, and particularly in Catholic education in America prior to the 1960s. In the 1960s, the whole nature of American university education changed pretty dramatically. And the idea of integrated liberal arts is something that really fell apart. We're one of the last places holding up the banner for that. Now, what does that mean? What that means is that there's really two main components to your academic experience here as a student at Christendom College. It means, on the one hand, you do get the opportunity as an upperclassman to pick a major field of study, right? You do get the opportunity to pick a field and concentrate in it, delve more deeply into the subject of your choice, or you can even double major if you want. You can major and minor, right? But before you even get there, your intellect has been refined and cultivated by progression through a core curriculum. Okay, Christendom College has a core curriculum that's over 80 hours, over 80 credit hours of core classes. There's nothing like that anywhere in the United States that I'm aware of, right? So what that means is that in the core curriculum, the idea is that every young man and woman, by completing the core curriculum, becomes well-rounded intellectually and becomes a liberally educated man or a liberally educated woman. Now, the fact of the matter is that there used to be a real consensus in Western society about what it meant to be liberally educated. And there used to be a real consensus that for anyone who was worth their salt intellectually, that was their background. Their background fundamentally was in liberal education. Now, what liberal education means in modern times is it's kind of a fusion of scholastic and humanistic ideals, right, which we try to emulate here at Christendom College. What that means is there's really two types of subjects in the core curriculum. You have ones that are strictly scientific, and you have ones that are humanistic. Okay, so on the scientific side, you have mathematics and natural science, you have philosophy, you have political science, and you have theology, which is the queen of the sciences. Okay. On the humanistic side, you have the study of languages, the study of literature, and the study of Western civilization itself, right? That is to say, the study of history. Okay. So humanistic studies actually complement and support the scientific studies that the students explore in theology, in philosophy, etc. And so any student who's gone through our core curriculum has had a rigorous education in languages, a rigorous education in literature, a rigorous education in history, but then they've also gone into the sciences. They've studied theology. Now, the way we do theology here is we start them out with doctrine. Okay, freshman year, any student who comes to Christendom College takes 1 year of Catholic doctrine. Now, the reason for that is some people object to that, and they say, now, wait a minute. Is it appropriate at the university level to be studying doctrine? Isn't that something that should be done in childhood? Isn't that something that should be done in First Communion classes and things like that? And the answer ultimately is yes. You know, doctrine class is a kind of a remedial thing, right? But the founders of Christendom College knew from day one that it was necessary, right? It is remedial, but it's absolutely necessary because it gets everybody on the same page as far as the faith is concerned. You start with a right faith, right? You start with what the Catholic faith is, and then you can make progress in the science of theology. If you don't have that common background in what the Catholic faith is, you can't start doing theology. You can't ask students to write papers on medieval or modern theologians when they don't even have the basis, in Catholic doctrine. Okay, so we start them out with doctrine, and then they study the Old Testament and the New Testament in depth in their sophomore year. And in their junior year, they study in depth moral theology and Catholic apologetics. Right. Now, that's just in the core in theology. Of course, theology majors then go deeper And they study the theology of the Trinity and of the sacraments. They study the theology of marriage and the family, specialized issues in scriptural theology, specialized issues in moral theology. Many of our students have gone on to do great things in the church. They've gone on to graduate studies in theology, gone on to the priesthood and the religious life, and you know, have really done tremendous things. But the basis of it is their education in theology here. There's a funny story about Father Benedict Groeschel. One time got picked up at the airport in New York by this guy who happened to be a Christendom grad. And Father Groeschel didn't know that. The two of them started chatting on the way from the airport up to the Franciscan monastery. And they talked for 45 minutes in New York traffic about moral theology. And by the time they got there, Father Groeschel was blown away. He had never met a layman who knew that much about moral theology. And the guy was just a Christendom grad. He got it in the core curriculum, right? The philosophy core curriculum, it's also six courses, right? So it also takes place over the course of 3 years. We start them out with an introduction to ancient philosophy and logic, right? So from day one, they're reading Plato, right? They read Plato, they read Aristotle, they study Aristotelian logic, first semester freshman year. Second semester freshman year, they move into the study of human nature, right? The philosophy of human nature, and that you rely on Thomas Aquinas. All of our philosophy is fundamentally Thomistic in its outlook. Then you move from there to the study of ethics. Sophomore year, you do ethics and then metaphysics, right? So the whole structure of the philosophy curriculum for the first four semesters is systematic. Logic, human nature, ethics, and metaphysics. Then, to kind of round out your philosophical education, the education in philosophy goes from being systematic to being historical. And so in the junior year, the students study the history of medieval philosophy and the history of modern philosophy so that they can understand the modern world. Now, once again, that's what every student does. Every student who comes to Christendom goes through that rigorous 18 hours in philosophy. Dr. Frederick Wilhelmsen had a fascinating article that he published in the 80s where he pointed this out. He said, you know, when we were all in universities before World War II, right, what made you a B.A., right, what made you a Bachelor of Arts was that everybody who had BA after their name, who was a graduate of a Catholic university, had those 18 hours in philosophy. Right? And Wilhelmsen talks about how when he was an officer in the Second World War in the Army, all the guys who had gone to Catholic universities could talk the same language, philosophically speaking. They were all products of that same intellectual formation. Right? And these weren't just priests and, you know, clerics. These were Catholic laymen. Right, that was standard in the 1940s, and it's something that we've really, as far as the broader church and broader society is concerned, it's something that we've really lost. Right, but Christendom still tries to bear the standard of that. So any Christendom graduate has those 18 hours in philosophy. Then philosophy majors, of course, go on to deeper and more advanced studies. You know, the deeper studies in medieval and modern philosophy, in ethics and epistemology, and more specialized fields. Okay. Now, what about mathematics and science? As far as mathematics and science are concerned, everybody in the core takes a semester of mathematics and a semester of science. And then we do have a minor in mathematics, but we don't have a major. So for students who are interested in the study of math, they can complete a minor in mathematics, but it's not as prominent a part of our approach to the liberal arts as some of these other disciplines are. Same with natural science. We have, you know, physics courses, we have some advanced courses in science, but we don't have either the facilities or the room in the curriculum to have, you know, large amounts of advanced study in the natural sciences or in mathematics, unless a student chooses to pursue the minor. Now, as far as literature is concerned, the literature core, I guess you have to look at it in conjunction with the history core. The literature and history core go together, okay? And it's really chronological. First semester freshman year, we do ancient and biblical history and ancient literature. Second semester freshman year, it's medieval history and medieval literature. Sophomore year, first semester, early modern history, early modern literature. Second semester, sophomore year, it's modern history and modern literature. Okay, and that's the core curriculum in history and literature. So by the time a student goes through 2 years, they've gotten that kind of cultural rounding out in history and literature. This is something that's very important to us, and I think if I can plug Christendom in a rather polemical manner, I think that part of our education is something that gives us a distinct advantage over places that neglect humanistic study, and particularly places that neglect the study of history. Christendom is founded on the idea, which is actually more traditional in Catholic education, that you can't understand texts without contexts, Right? You can't understand theology and philosophy without understanding the world that produced great works of theology and philosophy. You can't understand great works of literature without understanding the world that produced those works. You can't understand Plato if you don't know anything about 5th century Athens, you know? And so with Christendom's core curriculum, we try to give every student that context. Every student gets that background in history and literature. Other things, political science. Every student takes a semester of political theory. Every student takes a semester of study in the social teachings of the church. Okay. So now all three of those, literature, history, and political science, are disciplines where we also offer a major. Right? So students can go on for more advanced study in history. They can go on to, you know, study the Middle Ages in a deeper way, to study modern America in a deeper way, to study intellectual history in a deeper way. The literature department has a wide range of specialties among their faculty, and they offer a tremendous range of elective courses for their majors. And same thing with political science. We offer a major in political science. There's a minor in economics that's offered by the political science department, and there's a practical course in politics, a politics practica course for 4 credits that students can take, and that involves being in D.C. a lot, taking advantage of our proximity to Washington, D.C. Now, the last thing I want to hit on in terms of the curriculum is languages. Every student takes 4 semesters of a language or the equivalent, okay? We do offer modern languages to fulfill that basic core requirement, right? But there's not a major in modern languages. What most of our students do is they take Latin, okay? And our Latin program is, it's one of the flagships of the college intellectually. It's one of the strongest Latin programs at the undergraduate level in the United States. We have some of the top Latinists and top Latin teachers here, guys who have been on the cutting edge at places like Columbia and Duke of devising new ways to teach the Latin language as a living tongue. And that's what Christendom does in its Latin education. So the vast majority of our students take 4 semesters of Latin, and they learn Latin as a living tongue. They actually learn to speak it and to think in it, and not just to, you know, translate things like you're balancing an equation or something like that, but to actually learn the language so that it can be used in later study, so that you can use it in the study of philosophy, use it in the study of theology, use it in your other work. Ultimately, that's what it's for, right? So the vast majority of our students take 4 semesters of Latin. You can then also go on, of course, and major in classical studies. And we offer not only a tremendous variety of courses in the study of Latin literature, but also in the study of Greek. I'm thinking back to my own undergraduate days. When I was an undergraduate here, I took 5 semesters of upper division electives in Greek, for example, and that was very helpful for me when I was applying for graduate schools and, you know, doing research later on for my PhD dissertation and all of that. So our classics program in Latin Greek is ultimately very strong, and that's why our graduates, when you come out with a BA from Christendom College, you come out with certain things. No matter what your major is, right? No matter what your chosen field of study is, no matter where you've chosen to specialize, when you come out of here with a BA in any of our fields, you come out as a well-rounded, liberally educated man or woman. You come out as someone who can talk conversantly about major ideas in philosophy, major ideas in theology, someone who studied Latin, in most cases, on a rather deep level, someone who is an educated man in a world in which educated men and women are few, right? Now, final thing to tack on, I know you've heard a lot about the career thing, but I know burning in the back of the minds of every parent is, okay, fine, you have a great education here, but what if I send my kid here and 4 years later they can't get a job? 4 years later they move back in. You know? Hey, Mom, here's my laundry. You know? I understand the fear there. I really do. I understand where people are coming from. It's tough times economically. You feel as a parent, it's part of your job to establish your children in life. You want your children to be established in life and be able to be independent and have fulfilling careers and all of that. And so what I do want to say is that our students have a spectacular track record, I think, out in the world of employment. We've, just thinking back to the people who graduated with me, which is 9 years ago now, I've been out for 9 years, and people who graduated with me are in virtually every field: medicine, law, politics, business. They're entrepreneurs in many cases, or they're professionals. There is no kind of dearth of tremendous success in the job market coming out of Christendom College. And I think it's because you come out with basic skills. You come out with the ability to think, the ability to write, and the ability to conduct yourself as a professional. Which really, I mean, our graduates go places, and they really set themselves apart. We got a letter from one law school that had accepted one of our graduates, and when he was here, he was kind of a B student, maybe. You know, wasn't exactly an all-star. But we got a letter from the law school that he was attending, and it was from one of his professors who wrote to the academic dean here at Christendom and said, you know, I just wanted to say, we've never had anyone in the first year of our law school who was as good a writer as this guy, and whatever you're doing something right up there. And so we're pretty pleased to get feedback like that. I think in general, our education, although it's education for its own sake, and it's a refinement of the mind and of the intellect for its own sake, it doesn't leave you at a disadvantage in the job market, quite the contrary. And so I think there's no contradiction in assuaging people's concerns on that front.